Don't worry, I haven't quit working on projects or anything. I just have an actual job now, so I can't really spend 60 hours a week working on projects anymore. I've still been slowly working on different things. The biggest being that I expanded to the second bay of the garage, so I now have a ton more space to work on stuff. I also got a CO2 laser cutter, which is going to help speed up a lot of prototyping, especially when it comes to cutting out all the small gaskets for the lightsaber. I also moved the other robot up here and got it running again, or at least as running as it was in its last video. Originally, there wasn't enough space for it since the stairs to the attic come down in the middle of the room. I ended up making a system that uses two large air-powered tool balancers, which are basically just air winches, to lift the stairs up out of the way. I have the pressure set just high enough to raise the stairs so they move really slow and aren't dangerous. Now that the robot is up here, I finally get to work on it more. It seemed to be running well enough, so I wanted to try running an actual G-code program with it. I 3D printed this little flexible pen holder so I could try drawing with it. Huh. Alright, so I made a new pen holder that should hopefully not do that. It's actually working a lot better than I thought it would. I can clearly see there's still following air that causes the lines to sort of be rounded or not quite line up, but it isn't nearly as far off as I expected. I did find some really weird issues while trying to run the program though. The controller kept losing connection to some of the motor encoders, and once they completely stopped working, the only way to get them to start responding again was to completely disconnect then reconnect the encoders. Normally whenever there's an issue that's solved by jiggling around or unplugging and replugging connectors, it normally means that it isn't making good contact. Trust me, that is not the issue. I cleaned and reseated all of the pins multiple times, but that never solved the issue. Just to be sure, I even hooked the scope up to the encoder directly at the robot and the signals looked perfectly fine. While trying to solve that issue, I noticed something else. The robot was making terrible crunching sounds while moving, almost like there was something in one of the gearboxes. However, it was happening with all the joints, not just one, which led me to believe it was in fact some weird software problem. I could clearly see a sudden brief spike in the current being sent to the motor, so I knew the controller was at least noticing it. But I couldn't tell if the controller or the O-drives were freaking out, then sending an incorrect current to the motor, or if the encoder was freaking out, and the controller and O-drives were just trying to correct it. I was playing around with some settings in linuxCNC, and I think I found what was causing both of the problems. These FANUC encoders need to be pulled at 8 kHz to start working, but linuxCNC can only update everything at 1 kHz. To handle that difference, the FPGA that is interfacing to the encoders has a separate timer that pulls the encoders at 8 kHz without any intervention from linuxCNC. Then later, linuxCNC pulls the latest encoder data from the FPGA and uses that for the PID loops. I think the issue is with the FPGA timer. It is synchronized to linuxCNC to get the encoder data just before the linuxCNC communication. That way, it'll always have the most recent data. Unfortunately, the FANUC encoders are very picky, and I think there is some variation in the polling rate, or even some overlapping of the transfers. Although I later found that it's actually possible to pull the encoders from 1 kHz to 12 kHz, as long as you start out at 8 kHz. So I don't think any slight variation would matter that much, but overlapping transfers could definitely break stuff. Actually, I should probably just get the logic analyzer and track the signals to see if I notice anything when it breaks. I ended up probing everything, and I don't think timing is the issue. The polling rate to the encoder seems perfectly fine. I was able to capture some of the events where there were problems, and it seems like the request byte from the FPGA is always consistent, but sometimes the encoder just sends back a short garbled response and then stops responding altogether. Then sometimes, without any warning, it starts back up perfectly fine. Since the encoders are RS-485, there are actually three states for the signal: high or low for data, or floating when neither device is communicating. So I resampled the signal in analog so I could see when it was left floating. I noticed these weird slight shifts in the signal happening at a consistent rate, and always directly after the encoder stopped responding. I figured I'd also sample the 5-volt encoder power as well to see if there was any weirdness there. It was reading only 4.8 volts, which is a bit low, but I think still within operating range. Since it seemed a bit low though, I also decided to measure directly at the encoders. When I did, I was only getting 4.5 volts, which is definitely low enough that it could be causing problems. To test if it was, I hooked up an external power supply to run the encoders directly. That way I could adjust the voltage and measure the current to make sure everything was operating correctly. The FANUC encoders are quite power hungry and only have thin wires run to them, so I had to raise the voltage all the way up to 5.5 volts at the controller to get 5 volts at the encoder. Since then I haven't had any issues with them, so I think the issue is they were simply not getting high enough voltage. I also worked on getting the servo PID loops tuned a bit better. The main issue I'm running into with them is getting the following error low enough. Following error is the difference between the measure position and the commanded position. So, the lower it is, the better the motor can follow motion paths and ignore disturbances. For motors like this, it should ideally be less than 0.1 degrees. The best results I could get were closer to 20 degrees. There's a bunch of different reasons why it's that large, but it mostly comes down to not using nested PID loops like industrial servo drives, and the slow current update rate of only 300 Hz the O-drives are limited to by the UART bandwidth. Because the following error is pretty bad, it means the robot can't accurately hold its position. If I push the robot, you can clearly see the position moving all over the place. The robot is rated for 440 pounds with 0.3 millimeter repeatability, so there's no way I should be able to move it anywhere near this much just by pushing on it. After messing with the robot for a few more days, I realized I had to make a decision. Do I continue to pour time into this current controller, or do I try to start over and make everything better from the ground up? When it comes to CNC type machines like industrial robots, milling machines, 3D printers, basically anything that you can program to move in weird ways, there are two main parts aside from all the mechanical stuff: the motor controllers and the motion controller. Most of you are probably at least somewhat familiar with motor controllers. They control motors. Pretty straightforward. Steppers, brushless motors, DC motors, whatever. Their job is to take the control signals from the motion controller and run the motor accordingly, normally by controlling the speed or torque for servo motors, or incrementing the position for stepper motors. The motion controller, however, seems to be greatly overlooked in the hobby world, which is strange because the whole mechanical system with gear reducers, motors, and motor controllers would be sacrificing a lot of performance without a good motion controller. For example, upgrading a 3D printer to run Clipper is essentially just upgrading the motion controller, and without any changes to the motors themselves, you can get a lot better performance out of it. The motion controller is what is in charge of telling the motors where to go so the rest of the machine does what you want it to. Normally it first does whatever interpreting or initial path planning is needed. For CNC machines, this would normally be reading the G-code program and converting it to a bunch of small steps that the machine can run through to match the program. Although instead of reading a program, it could be something more dynamic, like reading position commands sent from an external computer, or even just simple jog buttons that manually move the machine. For robots like mine, it then also needs to do the inverse kinematics. They determine the joint positions given an end XYZ position, of which it normally has multiple solutions to pick from due to how the joint angles can often be mirrored and still reach the same position. It also needs to do the velocity, acceleration, and ideally jerk limiting so the motion is smooth, both before and after the inverse kinematics. This also factors into how closely it can follow the programmed path and speed. Fancy expensive machines might do additional stuff like compensating for mechanical deflection, factoring in the mass and inertia of moving parts to better estimate the required motor torque, dynamic friction compensation, or even thermal compensation to account for stuff like ball screws expanding and contracting at different temperatures. The motion controller I'm using is linuxCNC. It really isn't meant for running 6-axis robots, and the kinematic solver it has for it is extremely basic. It does zero post-processing after the inverse kinematics, and only does motion planning for the joints or the axes, but not both at the same time. This means when it is doing a linear move, all it cares about is the linear acceleration and speed. It does not care if a motor directly is going to exceed its maximum speed or acceleration. It just keeps telling it to go until it airs out since the motor can't keep up. Real industrial robots will slow down the move or warn you if it's not possible to do it at full speed. LinuxCNC also has no jerk limit, which is a bit newer in terms of hobby level controllers, but even most 3D printers have it due to how much it helps. Instead of just smoothing out the velocity profile with acceleration limiting, jerk limiting smooths out the acceleration, which in turn smooths out the torque coming from the motor. This greatly helps reduce mechanical vibrations and will give you better motion in the end. Unfortunately, each time you go up a level, the planning gets harder and harder, especially when you have a bunch of different motors that all need to move in sync. It can require quite a lot of processing to make sure all the motors follow the limits and still move the way you need. One of the other aspects that actually makes LinuxCNC good also hurts it when it comes to really high performance controllers. It's simply a program running on a normal PC. It does have a real-time version which helps with better timing, but it simply cannot directly handle the high-speed signals from encoders or generate the pulses needed to run a bunch of stepper motors directly. It is also limited in how fast it can run the PID loops for the servo control. I was only able to get around 1 kHz reliably. I would definitely like to run the loops faster since the FANUC encoders can run up to 12 kHz. Being able to use all those data points would get better velocity and acceleration estimates, rather than ignoring most of them like it does when it only updates at 1 kHz. For interfacing to any higher speed signals, LinuxCNC needs additional hardware. I use these FPGA cards that are specifically designed to work with LinuxCNC. They handle all the high-speed real-time signals. Aside from all the LinuxCNC stuff, the motor controllers would also need a lot of work. Even if I improved the O-Drive firmware, I doubt I could get an update rate much faster than the current 300 Hz. Ideally, the update rate would be closer to 3 kHz. They are also only 48 volts, which is way less than what these motors would like to run off. But they were, and probably still are, the best budget option for getting motors like this running at all. Ideally, they'd be running closer to 300 volts. Lower voltage alone is wasting a ton of potential performance and limits me to only around 15% of how fast this robot is rated to go. In addition, the O-Drive V3s I'm currently using are now end of life and aren't recommended for new designs. The newer versions are definitely more rugged, but would still run into the same low voltage issues. They are also no longer open source, so I couldn't use the same firmware changes I did for the V3s. I'd instead need to find another way to trick them into thinking an encoder is connected and only interfacing over serial, or maybe even have them talk to the encoders directly instead. Because of how much work would be required to get LinuxCNC and O-Drives working as well as I want, I've decided to just start over. I can't justify spending so much time on something that likely won't end up meeting my needs in the end anyway. Plus, a lot of the software and hardware this thing uses is no longer maintained and is either obsolete or getting to end of life. And that's where this thing comes in. This is the very first prototype of a motor controller I've been working on that's specifically designed to run all sorts of industrial motors. Now, since this is the first one, chances are it will explode, but that's normal. That's also why I didn't solder on all the through-hole components yet. The main MOSFETs are almost 50% of the cost of the whole unit, so if something else breaks, I'd prefer not to need to try to desolder a bunch of $20 transistors. Once fully assembled, it will bolt onto a section of this heatsink and get two small fans to keep everything cool. It should be able to output up to 450 volts at 60 amps, which is more than enough to run the most common sizes of industrial servos up to their full 300% peak output. Since the power circuitry is basically identical for running most types of industrial motors, this drive will be able to run a huge range of them at their full torque and speed, from these tiny 100-watt servos you might find in desktop-sized robots, to the massive 5,000-watt ones in robots like this. If you mess with the firmware, you can also run induction and DC motors with no extra hardware. Or even weirder, if you add some inductors and sense leads, you can use them as AC to DC rectifiers with active power factor correction. After all, our AC power is essentially generated by huge motors working as generators, so it's basically just really long-distance regenerative braking. They can even boost up to a higher voltage than you input, so you could run robots at full speed off just the normal 120-volt outlet, providing, of course, you don't go past the power limit. It could even dump power back into the grid so you don't need to waste it through a braking resistor during deceleration. Some of the newest FANUC controllers do that as well to help save energy. The active power factor correction is actually super useful, since it's not very easy to find cheap, high-power 300-volt DC power supplies. And using a simple full bridge rectifier will only draw current at the peaks of the AC input. The active power factor correction will draw current that matches the entire AC input and is way more efficient. But those motor controllers are only half the solution. I also need a motion controller. Technically, I could write another interface and use them with linuxCNC instead, but I decided to start new with this as well. The main challenge with running a bunch of different types of motors isn't necessarily the motor itself. It's actually the encoder on the back that gives the position data back to the controller. Most industrial manufacturers have their own proprietary protocols that aren't compatible with one another. Because of this, there's next to zero documentation on them, and the only way to reverse engineer the protocol is by probing and testing on an active system. Since there are tons of different protocols, and I need at least 6 encoders, most common microcontrollers just won't cut it. A few people mentioned I should just replace all the encoders with something easier to communicate with. However, the industrial encoders that come on these robots are completely different from the common quadrature ones that something like O-drives come with. They output 2 sets of pulses that are offset by 90 degrees that the controller can keep track of to find the relative rotation. The cheap ones normally have single-ended outputs, which means each signal is only one pin. This is an issue since electrical noise from the motors can couple onto those wires and cause false readings. Almost every industrial encoder uses what are called differential signals. Instead of just one wire, they use 2 for each signal, with the signal on the second wire being the inverse of the first. These wires will get twisted together, so any noise will affect both wires equally. The controller then only reads the difference between that pair. That way any noise will be ignored and the signal will be extremely reliable. Some industrial machines still use quadrature encoders, but most modern machines have switched to serial encoders. Instead of constantly sending back pulses when the position changes, they internally keep track of the position and digitally send back the number when the controller asks for it. This can allow for much higher counts per turn, since the controller doesn't need to keep track of millions of pulses per second if the encoder is very high resolution and spinning at full speed. But more importantly, it allows for the encoder to send back more than just a single position count. These FANUC encoders have a 16-bit absolute position that is roughly 65,000 counts per turn, and another 16-bit count for multiple turns that has battery backup. The multi-turn battery backup is super important because otherwise you would need to rehome the robot every time you turn it off. The encoders internally save the position even if you unplug the robot from the controller. They will even wake up from low power mode and track if the motor moves without being connected to the controller. They also have a small 8-bit counter for motor commutation, along with several status bits to alert the controller if the battery backup is low or if it has been reset and lost the multi-turn count. It even has contacts that connect to a temperature sensor inside the motor to warn you if it overheats. I would definitely prefer to use these encoders if at all possible, since they'd be so much better than any cheap replacement. And that's where FPGAs come back in. FPGA stands for Field Programmable Gate Array. They are basically a ton of raw logic gates that you can trick into doing all sorts of stuff incredibly well. They are perfect for this since I need something able to keep track of a ton of different types of encoders at data rates up to around 10 megabits without wasting a lot of processing time. And since they're field programmable, support for new encoders can easily be added without any board changes. Basically, just a firmware update will allow it to use more types of encoders, providing they still use similar differential signals. They can also do much more complicated stuff, like hardware acceleration for motion planning. Because they're so powerful and efficient, they get used in tons of high-end applications. Almost all industrial servo drives use them, along with all sorts of crazy military-grade stuff. Of course, there are also downsides. FPGAs are on a whole other level of complicated. The tools to program or synthesize and then simulate them are insane. I have basically zero experience with them, but that's never stopped me before, so wish me luck. They are also not cheap. The chips I plan on using include both an FPGA and a dual-core microcontroller all in one package for $50 a piece. Since they're pretty expensive, I'm planning on using just one to handle all of the encoders, rather than a separate one for each motor controller. The downside is the motor controllers will need the motion controller to send them some encoder data back so they can drive the motor properly, but I don't think that's that big of an issue. The whole system for the robot would essentially look like this. There would be 6 main drives to run the robot, another 1 or 2 to handle the power factor correction, and probably another for a spindle so I could still try to use it as a fancy 6-axis wood router. I'd also need some sort of safety brake module to power the motor brakes and make sure all the e-stop and safety stuff is reliable. and also probably some sort of I/O module for general purpose inputs and outputs like buttons, probes, indicators, and dust collection control. All of those modules would then plug into the motion controller, along with all the encoders. This would give what I think would be a pretty decent robot controller. If nothing else, it would at least be versatile. I would love to have a nice web interface for the controller that would make it super easy to configure for all sorts of different setups. I mean, the hardware would all be there. It could run normal CNC mills or lathes just as easily as it could the robot. I could also make much lower power motor controllers that would drive normal stepper motors for running 3D printers. And with these little absolute encoder boards I've been working on, I could easily get full closed-loop control and eliminate the risk of losing steps. Or even better, I could just switch to NEMA-sized brushless motors and get way higher performance and speed. I actually have a 3D printer project lined up to do just that, but I haven't had the time, or more importantly, the controllers, to do it yet. Honestly, almost all the cool projects I want to work on require servos and motion control stuff, so I figured I should find a good, at least somewhat cheap solution for that first. I'm hoping this thing will make it a lot easier for me to use the industrial surplus motors and machines you can find for super cheap. I am going to have most of this project be open source, probably the whole motion controller and whatever interface protocols I settle on to talk between the modules. I know ODrive had issues with open sourcing their stuff due to the rather high level of knowledge required to make any contributions. It ended in not much contribution and a lot of not so great knockoffs instead. I think that would honestly be about the same for a lot of the low-level stuff, but I would still want people to be able to design other compatible modules, or add support for new encoders or kinematic systems if they really wanted. I also don't really plan on pushing this thing as too much of a product unless there's a ton of interest. I just needed it myself and figured it might be helpful to others as well. Also, to be completely honest, I have no idea if everything could work out the way I described. I mean, I think it could, obviously. But there's so much that needs done and tested that I'm sure it's going to change at least somewhat. If you have any questions or suggestions, feel free to comment or join the Discord. It'd be great to see what everyone else thinks. If you want to help move this project along, it is open source like I said, so you could contribute, but currently I have basically nothing, so there would need to be a lot of initial planning and organizing. Once I get it moved further along, I'll post more update videos on the specific parts. Alternatively, you can help get my current YouTube profits a bit more viable by subscribing and liking, or you can join my one Patreon supporter so they won't be so lonely. If I ever do some interactive projects, Patreon supporters will be first in line. Thanks for watching.